Hi there, Board Boy Cam here, to do the intro for another episode I'm not on. I would have loved to have used the intro that these guys recorded, but instead of recording an intro, they talked about Mr. Beast videos for 5 minutes, and then recorded an intro in which they goofed up in the middle and then just kept going. How does that help Cam, you guys? Come on, help Cam, please. I'm just sitting here all sad, editing a podcast I wasn't on. Anyway, here we go. The galaxy is organized, sorry for the static, into many coalitions that govern multiple solar systems and worlds. Your system wants to join one of these federations. Your fledgling empire is small, but that will not stop you. It is your job to impress the petty bureaucrats who control access to the federation that your tiny government should be taken seriously. Becoming a full member would give you advantages over your rivals, but yours is not the only delegation that has set its sights on joining the Federation. So, the contest begins. Today on the board, boys, minus Cam, Federation.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast, Season 13, Episode 13. This has got to be a lucky episode, I feel like.
Or wait, isn't 13 unlucky?
Or an unlucky episode. I'm trying to spin it good, guys. There's a black cat walking around here somewhere.
There is, yeah.
I don't know.
He's asleep. So by hotel standards, this is Season 14, Episode 14.
Correct, yeah. We just skip it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a weird thing that not all hotels do, but a lot of them do.
I don't know that I've ever seen a hotel that has a 13th floor.
I think I definitely have hit the 13th floor in an elevator before.
Yeah.
So when it's not there, I think it's weird. Or maybe I think it's weird when it is there. I don't know.
Like, just because you number it different, does it make it?
It's still the 13th floor,
right, okay.
People.
All right.
There's a Mitch Hedberg joke where he's like, if you jump out the window, you know what floor you're on.
You know what? Well, this is a board game podcast, so let's talk about some board games. Hey, everybody. This is Board Boy Rob.
This is your board boy, Lappy McLapperson, TK.
This is your board boy, my planets didn't get no respect in voting, Jake.
Jake is the Rodney Dangerfield of space. Jake, what you been playing, man?
Well, I don't have a ton I want to talk about. Just two things, I think. I played Pies. It is a 3-5 player card game. It's by Matthias Kramer, and it is the publisher's All Play. It's I don't really know how to describe this. Essentially, you get dealt a hand of five cards, and those cards aren't your cards, but you use them to play a card, and then whoever plays the highest gets assigned a draft order, and then whoever plays the highest card then drafts the first of the cards that are out there. So it's weird to like look at your hand and think, I may not even get these cards. But then from there, some cards have abilities, and some cards have scoring conditions, and upon taking the card, you then can fulfill a scoring criteria. So, and you're trying to get like two of a kind or three of a kind or a run from there. The art is really, really, really good on it. That was something I noticed right off the bat, and actually a couple of the people that I played with commented on that. It's interesting. I want to play it again. It's light. It's plays up to five people, which is kind of nice for a card game. And it was a really easy introduction to some, you know, holiday time for the people that I was playing with. So that was good. And then I want to talk about, it's something I've talked about before, but Amsterdam, which is the Macau remake from Stefan Feld. So I played it twice. Actually, I think three times at the beginning of this year, and I really liked it. There's enough strategic planning to it that is just absolutely brutal if you aren't planning accordingly and how bad it can hurt you. And I don't think I'd had a game yet where the dice that were rolled, so essentially dice are rolled and you take a number of resources based on the number of pips, but you get those resources that many turns in the future. So if you take a six of the pink resource, you get six resources six rounds from now, and just the whole game, the dice just never cooperated, and when people would need a specific number to come up so you don't take a penalty token, which ends up being like -8 points per at the end of the game, it just, those dice didn't come up, so we had so many penalty tokens. So I think the most I'd ever taken was one, maybe two, and I took five, which was -29 points at the end of the game.
Did anybody score points?
Yeah, I mean, we still were all about 100 when we played it, but it was just brutal. And I think a lot of people would just hate this game more than anything ever. There's just enough like stuff I like about the way the mechanisms work that it keeps me interested, but I don't know. It was a rough, rough, rough play. So I'm curious if that is more the norm that people have experienced, and my previous ones weren't that. Maybe it, part of the difference was we played four players instead of... I'd always played lower player counts than that, but I still really like it. I love Stefan Feld, but it was a rough, rough game. So that kind of changed my perception on it a little bit.
Is the all-play game you mentioned, the pies, is that one of the little square box
games?
Yes,
it is one of those little square box
games. They love those little square boxes.
They are all about them right now. Every time I go to Dungeons Gate, there's like 12 more of them than were there before. So
They're like rabbits.
Yeah.
They just keep popping out. I just want to talk about a couple of games that we played over the holidays. One was Santa's Workshop by Elf Creek Games. Designers Keith Ferguson and artist is Andrew Bosley. Santa's Workshop, this is a reprint. They did a Kickstarter. They then sold a bunch on their website. I think it's going to come to retail this year. So you can play it for Christmas next year.
Yeah, they missed the window there.
Yeah, long story short, this is a game that I will play probably every December, and I won't play it if it's not December. Mm. But it is also a game that if your family members come over that don't play board games and you want to play a board game with them, and you want to play something like introduce them to maybe worker placement, because that's what this is. This is your super basic, super simple worker placement game. Anybody can play it. Play with grandma. Play it with your kids. There's two sides of the board. We played the basic side at the family Christmas, and we've played the advanced side with some more gamery people. It held my interest on both sides.
What's the big difference?
Well, the basic side is it's only 6 rounds instead of 9 rounds.
Okay.
And on the basic side, you're just placing your workers out, getting things, and you have these present cards, and you're just trying to basically set, collect to match the stuff on the cards, then deliver it, or take these ornaments and put them on your tree. And then twice during the game, you check your Christmas cheer, like whoever's completed more presents and has more ornaments will get some points, like for first, second, third, and fourth place. And this also, I don't know if I mentioned it, it plays up to 5 people, which is great. And it comes like a little cool cardboard sleigh that you, after you complete your presents, you give them to Santa and he puts them in a sleigh. So it's kind of cool. The other side is 9 rounds, so it lasts a little longer. And there's a material called coal that you don't play with in the basic game. And basically most of your actions cost coal. And then there's a place you can go get coal. And then you can upgrade your board in some different ways. So you can pay to upgrade it, like you can pay so you can hold more coal, or pay so on both sides of the board you can get these reindeer. The reindeer all have like special abilities on the advanced side. Otherwise, they're also just like set collection. You want all the different named reindeer. Super solid game. Like the price point is like $40 or something. Everyone I played it with really liked it. So I would check out Santa's Workshop for next Christmas.
I remember... Did you have the other version?
Dave Koontz did. Yeah.
So somebody in our game group had it.
Yep, I played it last Christmas, and then I saw the Kickstarter come out, and I was kind of like, yeah, whatever. I wasn't that into it, but then I kept seeing people get theirs online and talk about how fun it was with their families. I'm like, gosh darn it. Yeah. So I went to their website and bought it from their website, and probably played it a half a dozen times in December. So
nice.
Yeah. The other two I wanted to talk about, we both played on New Year's Eve. One is called Tricky Dicks, the Richard Measuring Contest. This is $10 on Amazon. If you and your family members want to measure your Richards, because this is just a deck of cards with Richard Nixon on them, and he's doing the famous I'm not a crook pose with the two fingers up. Basically, all you're doing is you split the deck evenly, and whoever is the current judge will look at their Richard Nixon. And they will say whether they have the largest or smallest or thickest or thinnest Richard Nixon. And whatever they say, you go around the table and everyone that wants to challenge that will slap their Richard Nixon down on the table. I'm saying the Richard Nixon, you know, instead. Yeah, but anyway, super funny game. You know, it lasted about 10 minutes.
So,
but like, it's just hilarious.
The pictures of Richard Nixon are actually like bigger and smaller.
Yes.
And
they're like all distorted. Okay, cool. Yeah, like some of them are like really distorted and really long, and some are really skinny, and like you're just trying to collect all the Richards.
That's funny.
And be the and, have the most at the end. Anyway, yeah, $9.99 on Amazon for a party. Go for it. It was a blast. The last thing I want to talk about is also kind of a party game. Bo picked this out with some Christmas money that he had. It's called Without Fail, and it is from Exploding Kittens, so we have to have it because of Bo. And the designer's Elon Lee. Without Fail is essentially a box of challenges. It comes with a blindfold, some cups, a ping pong ball, some pieces of paper, and a timer, a 30-second timer. And it's a pretty neat game, actually. It was fun to play for the holidays with the family. You take a card and you gather the required supplies. Sometimes it's stuff that didn't come in the box. Like we had to go get some toilet paper once. Or like if you didn't have the paper in the box or you ran out, you have to get it. So you may need a household item here or there. If you don't have it, you know, just bury the card and go to the next one. But essentially all you're doing is you're setting the stuff out. And then the person to the left of you, on that card, it'll tell you how they can make it harder. And it might be like one of them was, it was a piece of paper and a pen. And one was move the pen and paper farther away from each other. And then some of them, a lot of them are just take time out of the timer. And you go around everyone goes around the table making it harder for the person doing it. But then as soon as everybody passes, the last person that made it harder is now their teammate. So those two people will score points if they can accomplish the goal. So then you flip the card over and you read what the challenge actually is because you don't know what it is by looking at the other side of the card. So like I had to do the paper and the pen one and the paper and it tells you what an easy, medium, and hard would be. So I think it said like hard was like 10 feet or something or 12 feet. But I had to fold the paper into an airplane in 30 seconds and throw it past where the pen was in the room. I failed at this.
Oh, come on, man.
And I mean, I made the airplane, but like my throws were not good. It also said you couldn't crumple the paper up. So like, It's pretty smart. There was one where like you had to throw a cup out of a ball and catch it back in the cup. And they were just going around the table saying a number higher and higher and higher, but you didn't know what you had to do until and like it was 12 in like 30 seconds. And I got 11 and my last one bounced out. Anyway, if you like fun little quick challengey things, this one was really neat. They do a lot of neat things, I think, over at Exploding Kittens. And as long as you don't mind going to find odd things, the toilet paper one was we just kept having to rip off a sheet of toilet paper and add it to a pile. And the actual challenge was to have them all on the table and then be able to throw them in the air and have them all in the air at the same time. But you could only throw them up one at a time.
Oh.
That was pretty funny to watch somebody try to do that.
That's
so
funny.
Anyway, those are the kinds of things that you'll find in the box.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. All right, I got one. It's actually, I print and played it, but it's out. It's called Flip Town. Okay.
I've heard of this.
Yeah, so it's a wild, wild, wild west, like you're a outlaw, and it's a flip and write. So you do it with a standard deck of cards. The print and play was like $5. It was actually really fun. But basically what you're doing is you're flipping three cards. So you have three rounds of five turns where you flip three cards on one turn. One of the cards goes into your poker hand. So you're trying to make a poker hand. The other two cards, one you play for the suit and one you play for the number of the card. So say I wanted to go to an area. The areas are suits. So there's a trail, which is hearts, which you basically ride down the trail. You can only go, you have to go farther than the last time you went. And you can't do anything backwards on the trail. There's the Badlands, which is spades, which is basically going to steal like chickens and cows. And you can eventually, you know, steal a train. So the number that you have there would mean the harder thing. So you steal a train, it's harder. That'd be the king. The mine, you dig down deep, you kind of take a couple trails there. And then there's the town, which is basically technology. So when you pick the suit, you pick the card, and that'll let you do, you know, whatever level of thing. And you essentially do that 15 times. It's Combo Wombo City. You can get the other actions from kind of all the different areas, from bonuses and things like that. Basically, the only kind of bad stuff that happens is you end up getting wanted, and at the end of the round, you... can get arrested depending on how wanted you are. I really liked it. I thought it was quite fun. The print and play was great. I think the MSRP on the game is $30.
That's what it looks like.
Yeah,
unfortunately, I think you can only get it on their website.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I was looking for it after I heard somebody talking about it, and I just didn't pull the trigger.
Yeah, it's got nuggets. It's got, you know, all kinds of stuff. It was really fun. I would suggest going spending the $5 and printing it out on a sheet of paper, and I don't know, we can run through it in 10 minutes. It was really good. The decision space about what card to keep, what card to use for the suit, and what card to use for the number was way thinkier than I thought it was going to be out of the gate. So it was real fun. That was Flip Town. Designer Steven Armini, artist Naomi Farrell, and it looks like the publisher is Right Stuff Games.
Yeah, it's cool. I'd like to check that out. It kind of reminds me, did you play the game on BGA with Cam about the trucking?
Yeah, I
did. And the cards and the trucking? I thought that one was kind of neat, too.
Yeah.
With a deck of cards. What was that called?
Flip and Stack or something like that. Flip Freighters.
Flip Freighters was pretty fun, too. And that looked like that was basically a deck of cards and a sheet of paper. So
yeah. You flipped a card, you stuck it in a truck, and if you didn't stick in the truck, you could use it to drive. Yep.
Well, tonight on the podcast, we played Federation from publisher Explore 8 and Eagle-Gryphon Games here in the United States. The designers, Dimitri Perrey and Matthew Verdier. Artist is Miguel Coimbra. It is currently 8.1 for 1,242 on BoardGameGeek. It came out in 2022. It plays 2 to 4 players, best at 4. Age 14 plus, 60 to 120 minutes playtime, and 3.68 out of 5 on the weight. Jake, why don't you tell us what we're doing in Federation?
Okay, so thematically, I don't know if I can tell you exactly, except that I know you're trying to get your planet as a permanent member of the Federation, but you're like binding planets to you in the how far you're getting on those tracks.
I got it more like you're doing actions in the Senate, which is the center of the board.
Yeah, for sure.
To influence each color planet.
To then want to vote for you.
To keep you in.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. Okay,
that's what I got.
So essentially, it's a worker placement game where you have 4 workers, and those workers are dual-sided. They're like poker chips. On the one side, you put them out, and they give you an upgrade to a specific action that you can send a mission to later, or you put them up number side, which is the number of votes that you're putting forth. And so the grid of where you place your workers is divided into 2 halves. And each of those halves corresponds with a certain planet multiplier. So 2 of them will be up at the same time. So, for instance, it might be the pink planet and the blue planet. And whichever side has more votes in the end will end up getting 2 points times whatever level you are at of influence on that planet. And then there's also some competition for the rows. Of, you know, each of the horizontal rows, who has the highest number of votes there, you're going to get points for your authority. And so each planet is going to do different things. So each planet really just has one primary mechanism, whether it's gathering resources or collecting people that give you modified abilities or giving you permanent income bonuses or instant scoring based on some criteria of where you're at. But you are placing your workers out and you are, you know, pushing yourself down those tracks while also trying to think about how many points can potentially be won at the end of the round. Another major component to it that is really different than I think maybe anything I can think of anyways is when you're putting your workers out. And if they are upgrade side, then that contributes to that planet's final project being funded, which then cues whether that is going to get whether that's going to score endgame points or not. So it's a whole lot to think about with your individual actions, not only in what you're trying to accomplish right then, but then also how that's contributing for you and for other people at the end of the round and at the end of the game.
All right, let's get it to the table and we'll be back.
Said, get in, Jackson. Come on.
And we're back. Let's talk about initial thoughts on Federation. Jake, you bought it.
Yeah,
Why'd you buy it?
Well, I saw this on Kickstarter, I guess a while ago now, because it's actually a 2022 game, and I thought it looked really interesting, and then I missed the window, and I just kept, every now and then something would remind me of it, and I'd think, oh man, when's that game coming out? And I'd look, and then it still wasn't there. And then Chris and Teresa Boat mentioned that they had it and had been wanting to play it, so I said, definitely bring that to Dungeons Gate, and we got it played probably in June or July was the first time, and then I just kind of kept thinking about it, and then eventually Dungeons Gate had it, and so I waited until their Black Friday sale, and got it and another game, and then got a free game. So I was pretty pumped to own it. So anyways, on my first play, I was really pleasantly surprised. I thought that there's just a lot to think about in a good way. Not necessarily in a paralyzing kind of way, I don't think, but definitely just a lot of weight on your decisions.
Yeah. So I was not expecting it to be as big. It's a table hog. The middle board is big. So my kind of first impression was, oh, this takes up a lot of space. Like, I was not, like, looking at the box. The box is, you know, normal size. Like, I think there's a lot of games that are coming out with the threefold center board, which, you know, ends up taking a pretty big space. But the art is really nice, and the player boards are nice. So I had a, you know, pretty positive impression kind of walking into playing it.
Yeah, I had not had this game on my radar at all. And then I saw them playing at Dungeons Gate a couple times, and just it looks super colorful. And so that just kind of drew my eye, but I really had no idea what it was about. Still didn't know what it was about until I watched a quick video today. But I kept seeing it at Dungeons Gate, and I was like, I mean, this looks like a really pretty, nice production style game. So I was very intrigued to give it a shot this evening. Let's go ahead and do our pros, I guess. I can start there. I think I just mentioned it. Like, the production seems really, really nice. Even though he bought this at Dungeons Gate, this seems like a Kickstarter-ish type copy, or like a deluxe copy. It has like the chips in it, dual layer boards,
all the plastic containers to hold everything.
Plastic containers. So that right there, I mean, it was on the higher price point side for a euro anymore, I think, but you got those deluxe upgrade things. So that seems about like in line with what you got. And it looks like there's a lot of variability, because at first, like, it took him a while to set the game up. And then at the end, we kind of talked about what could have been different or changed. And a lot of the different areas that I was concerned with, like, oh, that might get old, there's like a lot of options for. So,
yeah, I think just about everything is customizable, which is, again, probably a good sign for long term.
The board is double sided. Right, so that has a bunch of different things on it, like different action spaces. Like, the action spaces are the same, but they're in a different place.
They rotate, which matters for the end game or the funding of projects.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, like, usually, Nucleum, for example, the one side of the board is 2-3 players. One side of the board is 4 players. This is, you mark off spaces for your worker placement with other tiles.
Yes.
So that lets them have 2 sides of the board to then, you know, kind of move some. I thought that was pretty cool. It was interesting.
Yeah, I think one of my favorite things about it is just I've played this 4 times now, and I've really went about it different ways each time. It really feels like most of the planets and tracks are pretty balanced. I think that there is a really fun level of, when do I go for a big scoring thing, because it's they're paired. So this is one of the green planet actions, but it scores you based on 2 criteria, whichever one you have the lower number in, and then there's a multiplier based on who gets there the first. And so you're kind of always playing this push or pull of, do I just get it now, or do I try to get a few more bumps before I do it? But then somebody like Tim might sneak in and steal it from somebody before they're able to get as many points as they could out of it. But I really like things that pull you to, when is the right time to do this? And I think that's really interesting.
Yeah, it'd be a whole different ball game if those were just end game scoring, which I originally, until Tim did it, for some reason I thought they were end game scoring. Mm-hmm. So when he got that many points in the middle of the game, I was like, what's going on?
Yeah. I like that all the tracks are not very complicated. Like, they're all pretty straightforward. You basically move a guy or take a thing or get some resources. And, like, they have some level of complexion to them, but it's not like there's 6 vastly different things that each alien race is doing or whatever. You basically move up a track, get some stuff, and kind of move on. I think that's that helps the game move at a pretty decent pace.
Yeah, I mean, I think we said this was like a 3.68 weight rating game. I think that's high.
I think it's high too. I was thinking that as soon as we said it.
If you're a Euro player, especially a heavier Euro player, this is going to be nothing. I mean, as far as, it's not like you have to understand this piece to figure out this piece over here. It's basically a bunch of little mini games that you're competing with, and then the voting thing in the middle, which I think is interesting. You can basically place your chip down to either vote or unlock an upgrade on your board, which once you upgrade on your board, then you can go do a mission on that spot as long as your other little token's high enough up. So maybe there is a lot going on, but it just seems like every little dinky thing just makes sense and is intuitive. Like, everything in here is intuitive, and it has two player aids. Like, I think if in a month, you know, I was to play this again, I could just look at those player aids and be like, oh, yeah, this is how this game works.
Yeah. Each individual part of the game is not very complicated, and then you kind of stack them on top of each other. You can have some monster, like, kind of combo-wombo turns, but it's not like they're super long.
No, your turn is never that. I mean, it might take a minute to decide, okay, what's the order of operations for where I need to place my worker at what point over the course of this round. But when you're doing your turn, I mean, at max, if you do a mission on the turn as well, then you're doing two actions. But none of those are longer than give me this stuff or this thing, and then that's essentially it. So I agree. It moves at a really healthy rate. And I guess another pro, you know, for the people who are maybe down on Euros because of the complete lack of player interaction, this is completely full of player interaction. It's everywhere. You know, what spots are going to get taken up, but also how is the vote going to go? Not only horizontal rows for your authority points, but also for which one is going to, you know, which of the two planet scoring is going to happen. And so there's a fun, how many votes do they have left? Can they get over top of me? And then sometimes you really want to take an action that's on the opposite side of the board. And so then you definitely don't want to contribute to that vote. It's just, I don't know, there's a lot of fun stuff to think about in that.
You don't notice it when you look at it, but now that we're talking about it and I'm looking back at it, this is secretly tracks the game.
Yes. Yeah.
Which, I mean, I like games with tracks in them. Mm-hmm. So there's just like a lot that they obfuscate the tracks a little bit in this one, I feel like. Because you're trying to push things far, because then there's going to be a scoring thing based on those. But then a lot of times they want to compare those between two things. Or this is not a game where you can go a little bit. You go a little bit into everything and you go hard into a couple of things, I feel like. But the things you go hard into, you got to make sure those votes get won too.
Yeah. Because if you are the only one really pushing a track, it doesn't do you any good to continue pushing that track, because it's never going to win the votes to score. And then also, nobody is trying to make that get funded at the end. So, like, that's a fun angle, too. Like, you definitely want to lean into something early, but then afterwards, you kind of want to get the vibe of how the game's going. And Tim did an excellent job this game of looking to see, okay, what's going to get funded? I need to get focused on those tracks where, you know, I guess Rob and I were both kind of just focusing on our own plans more so than that level. But
I think all the planets are fun, like all the different actions. I think they all feel good. Like, none of them feel boring or like, oh man, I gotta do this thing that's not interesting. They all have their own interesting thing about it. I mean, a couple of them are just kind of getting resources, like getting resources or getting the token you can put on top of your mm-hmm. chip. But that's, you need that stuff to survive, right? Yep. That's just resource gathering. This little special ability guys feel cool. The scoring things and the income guys, the green planets are cool. The yellow one is interesting, where you like pay to move up. And then when you move up again, like you get like three times the mm-hmm. stuff. I don't know. It's all just very, everything you do is fun. Like, the game loop is fun.
Yeah. I like the yellow planet is basically like a, I don't know, like a shop where you spend something to get something else. And then the second time you do that same, I don't know, column, you get it times three. But even like the dullness of like exchanging resources, that's basically what you're doing. You're going there to exchange resources, is exciting by like kind of the game it plays by moving stuff up. I think, you know, that was a good way to do something of just take a pink cube and turn it into a green cube or three green cubes.
Right, because they all score, right? So nothing is mundane if everything can score you points.
And I think that's just a really that's a really neat aspect too, in that there is a mini race on each of those planets as well, because we haven't really talked about the Medals of Honor, but there is a, so basically the in a four player game, it's the first person to reach the third level of a planet, and then in a three player game, it ends up being the fourth. But once you've reached that threshold, you get one of these tokens that you, if you get all eight of them, is worth 28 or 30 points. So there's a race, and you see how far people are in those, and those tracks, and that pushes you to go there faster. So there's just a, I don't know, a lot of the good kind of interaction, in my opinion.
Yeah. I think the star for me is the worker placement's fine, but like the, am I going to, so on the worker placement board, there's two sides, and you flip over two tiles, the beginning, like the beginning of the round, and either left, right, or left side or right side, that's the planet that's going to score whatever wins the votes there. And then it's divided into six columns. And at the top of the column is an end game scoring for a planet type, or not exactly a planet type. There's a couple other ones.
I think it's all but one of them is a planet type. Yep.
Yeah. And so, like, you have to decide, am I going to put my vote down to win the scoring of the round on left and right side, or do I need to flip my token over to fund something at the end of the game? It's a, like a little bit lightning bolt, infinity symbol thing. And then on top of that, the rows all the way across the two sides, at the end of the round, if you have the highest votes in that row, you'll score points equal to your,
your authority.
Your, like, your level on the side of your board. Like,
yeah,
the push pull between all, like, whether you're going to flip your token over, the votes, I loved it. I thought it was really good.
Yeah. So maybe the weight is more in the grand strategy of everything more than the rule set, which lends to what a good game is in my book, because if the rule set is easy to understand and, like, get into, even when it's this heavy, there are a lot of factors to consider based on scoring. Like, not only are you trying to push up all the planets, another scoring thing is, like, this dice thing that you can move up that gives you influence, like, when you're voting. And also that, whatever that track is on the side of the your player
authority.
Board, your authority,
yeah, authority, yep.
That's another thing to manage, and you can score off of that. I think those are the kind of the eight things. There's six planets?
There is. There's the dark orange, the yellow, the pink, the blue, the green. There's five planets, because there's five rounds.
So there's five planets, the dice, the authority.
Completed missions.
Completed missions. Yep. So, like, those are kind of the eight things that they kind of compare against each other, I think, when you're scoring stuff. And not only that, you then can score based on, you know, the votes for the rows at the end. So there's a lot of ways to be like, oh, I need to do this here and this here and this
but
here.
But additionally, even on your board, like, the whole top half of those missions are scoring things. And, like, so you get, you can do missions in the beginning to get, like, a double action, which is awesome, but then also you're kind of giving up your ability to score something later because you don't have enough ships for every mission that's on your board.
Yeah, that was my first play issue that I had, because you said ships were so cool. I was like, okay, I want to get a lot of ships. But, I mean, Tim and I used all our ships.
I used all my, I had one ship left.
But the problem is, I used all my ships, and most of them were on the getting a bunch
stuff.
Of, but that allowed me to get a bunch of stuff.
Yep. And score points.
But at
when
the top, I'm like,
across.
Okay, which one of these things at the top do I want to actually score now and maximize? But to do that, you also have to have upgraded it and checkmarked it, and you have to have your marker, your authority marker up high enough. So there's a lot of factors that come into that.
It's one of those feelings where it's like, if I just had X, and I think if I just had one more ship, or if I just had one more authority bump, and or one more jewel of this type, or and then it's kind of fun too, because the blue jewels are, can be used as either a pink or a green, which are lesser resources. But there's just time where you're like, man, this sucks that I got to use this, but I need to be able to do this action. So I don't know. There's just it pushes all the right buttons. I guess really for what I'm looking for in a game. One other thing, and we mentioned this before, I think before we actually started recording, but you know, we talk about that ability to wobble into stuff. And, like, if you're just not going into a planet, so let's say, for instance, you're ignoring the orange one, which gives you a lot of resources, there's still so many other ways that you can get resources without having to go there that's fun. Like, you can take the blue track and just always be modifying your dice, or you can be exchanging stuff at the yellow, or get your incomes, which are just going to give you a steady amount of resources in some cases. So, I don't know. I really like the ability to kind of backwards your way into the action that you want to take without having to go down a track that is maybe not as meaningful for you.
Yeah, you can use your ship to go on a mission to kind of help some of those things. And some of the the worker placement is what feels like tight and also not super punishing. Like, there's enough spots there that are a little bit of wilds, and but there's two spots for every planet. There's two wild spots, and then there's like three or four spots where you can kind of do some other stuff, get ships, mm-hmm. in, up your authority, things like that. And then you block them off depending on how many players you have, so that they're kind of there's not as many, right? Like,
yeah. So each round it'll rotate. So in a three-player game, effectively you're flipping over this token, and it tells you which side of the board you're blocking a colored planet on, but that's balanced throughout the game that each planet's going to be covered the same amount of time. So you're having equal access there. But
and when you block them, the blockers have votes on them sometimes.
Yes.
So like the farther you go in the game, they have a lot more votes, which I don't know. I think it's very interesting. Like it never felt like I had absolutely nothing to do with my worker, but also that, you know, sometimes going last wasn't great. Sometimes going last was good. It was cool.
Yeah, it's neat that going last sucks for worker placement, but it's great for maybe being able to influence the vote mm-hmm. away. There's just certain times, and it's all situational. Like, there were certain votes that I'm like, this matters not at all because they're about the same and they're low. And like, but when the one comes up that you're cranking hard on, then you're like, okay, I need to win that one. But also, even if you get your authority up higher, you get some decent points for just winning those rows as well. Mm-hmm. So,
and then the higher the authority, the more cost you have to pay at the end of the round too. So yeah. There's kind of a mechanism there that holds you in check. Also to note, on the taking the first player marker, you get one of the Medal of Honors of your choice. So that lets you get the benefit from ignoring a certain track. So there's a really valuable component to taking that action as well, in addition to setting yourself up for the future.
Anybody have any cons?
Yeah, I mean, I think that having played this for every time before this and this, I definitely think I do like four-player most, so I think that's probably the way that I would recommend the game. With two players, you block off even more actions, and maybe that actually even feels better because there's only two people, and then there's some actions that aren't blocked off. I'm not sure, but essentially it just, you're covering up, you know, three planets effectively each round. And when that comes out, I suppose could be really hurtful if you really needed to push something toward the end and then it didn't get there. I mean, I don't think it's bad by any means with three players. I mean, I don't know that either of these two would have a negative opinion having just played it this way, but I think four players is the way to go.
I mean, I thought how they handled it was fine.
Yeah.
I mean, I have no litmus test for
Fair,
a four-player game, but I don't think I'd have any qualms trying this with two players either, to be honest.
Yeah, like I said, I wonder if that might even be better because you're blocking off more things and then it probably ends up being more equitable each round for what's there and what's not. But again, I don't think it's debilitating. And on a spin to that, one of the things that's, you know, if you haven't played a game in a while, what's hard is the setup. And you always have to go back to the rule book. Okay, with how many players, what adjustments do I need to make? It's really nice that there are no adjustments for this. Everything is exactly the same, other than you are going to flip that tile over that shows you what things are going to get blocked. So I'm not putting less blue tokens out. I'm not putting less asteroids out. I'm not putting less of the pink character tiles. So you never have to worry about, hey, I need to look up how many of these come out each round, which is pretty cool.
It did look like there was a fair amount of setup for this one, though.
I think so. I mean, I think if you have some more than one person that's played it and you're dividing that by two, that probably speeds it up quite a bit. But I don't think it's not
crazy.
The worst. No. But it definitely takes a little bit of time for sure.
Well, you know, that's what you get when you also get a lot of variability with your stuff, right? Is mm-hmm. if you have to, you know, randomly pick some things out that are different every game. That's the pro for me too.
I agree.
That's your trade-off.
I mean, I guess you could say this is a con. I do want to add the caveat that not every game should be everything to everybody, and I think that's something that's just happening in board games more, where maybe a game isn't the right fit in a solo context, but this doesn't have one, but it also really couldn't have one because of the voting, because you obviously would just... I don't know how you'd automate the bot going against what's in your best interest, but there isn't a solo mode for this. But again, I don't think that there should be, but if you're somebody who primarily does solo games, this wouldn't have that availability for you.
Yeah. I'm sure there'd be a way to do it, though.
You could probably in-house it, but like, the votes make that hard.
David Turtsey, he is the solo king. He would make some 40-page convoluted bot that would work and be awesome that I'd never want to use because I don't want to read all those rules.
Yeah, you just play two-handed.
I would just play against myself
yep.
and be like, what's the best move over here?
So we did reference the rules a little bit for some of the pink guys. So there's a little bit of weirdness there. Like some of the symbols, like is this one instant? I guess the instant's pretty, like the lightning bolt's instant. But like, do you do it when you go to the planet? Do you do it whenever you want? Do you do it? Like there was a little bit of that. Like,
I would say this isn't a huge iconography game, but the iconography that is there is maybe not the best.
It's definitely not as intuitive.
I don't think it's terrible.
Yeah.
But there's definitely some things that were like, what does that mean?
Yeah. No, I definitely agree with that.
I mean, that's quibbling a little bit, I think.
Yeah, I would agree. Like,
I am too searching for something negative to say.
Yeah.
Because I enjoyed this much more than I mean, I had no opinion either way, but yeah.
Yeah. Like, I could see a game of this, if not going well, you could feel pretty bad. Like, for the most part.
Like, when you get lapped twice?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, that's a given. Like, so, but, like, you can get blocked out of spaces. You can get taken over in votes. You know, you could swing from having, like, say you're going first. You put your votes on there. You could swing from scoring like 12 points to scoring zero pretty easily, depending on what those scorings are. You could lose rows pretty easily. So, like, if you're a person that does not like that conflict.
Right. I mean, some Euro players, if you want heavy interaction in your Euro, this is it. If you don't, this is not it. This is not multiplayer solitaire. Yep.
Yeah.
There's a lot of interaction, more than I would say a typical Euro. And now that I think about it, like, I'd like to play it with four because I bet the voting is...
Oh, yeah.
I think the voting in this game was fine. I never thought, like, oh, yeah, but it's... There's only really one vote that I want. I'm like, this has to go this way. Yeah. Every other vote, I was like, it's about the same for me, so I don't care. So maybe that would happen more than I think. I don't know.
I've definitely had games where, I mean, you have two people with a lot of votes that are on the complete opposite sides, and then it's just a matter of how is this going to go. One thing I want to add to Tim's comment, and I think that it's valid, but nothing is secret information in this game, which I think helps that. You can always see how many votes people have left, and so it's not like there's a thing that you didn't even know existed that completely takes away your potential to score. But it can just be a matter of, like, for instance, I was heavy into the blue planets, and just those just didn't score either time because neither of the other two really had anything there, or the other option was better. And so part of that is just, like, risk management, you know, how that's going to come up and how you you know, work to make that happen. But
yeah, in a three-player game, there would be a chance, like, because each of us kind of spread out across the tracks, but also hammered one specifically. But if you flip the tiles and you're you're the one that you're hammering is on one side and the other two players are on the other side, like, there's no way you really win that one.
And I guess I experienced that. So I think, again, that probably goes back to maybe why it'd be a little bit better for players, because it's less likely that all three of them are going to do it. And also on that note, for, you know, if you aren't somebody who likes that kind of interaction, there's also no reason to do something just to hurt somebody in this game. Like, you're just going to do the math of how many more points am I gaining or losing as a result of this decision versus what everybody else does. And that's what you're going to do. So
I guess the blockers put votes on both sides, but they tended to always vote.
They're even. It only matters for the row. And so it just makes it so you can't win, though. So it's for the round. So the first round, they're one. The second round, they're two. So
I think it'd be more interesting if they came out randomly and one side was ahead. I don't know why, but I think that would be more interesting.
Man, but that'd be brutal, though, if that was the opposite way that your big thing was
in. I don't disagree, but, like, I don't know. It just felt...
Yeah.
I mean, I get both ways, but, like, I wouldn't mind it being the other way.
Again, that's why I think four players better, though, because there's none of those that are out there. Every option's available, and it's just the votes that you and your peers put out there. And
yeah,
because
then you figure it's, you know, maybe it's 2v2 or it's 3v1. You know, very rarely are all four people probably going to want it to go one way.
And sorry for going back to cons for a second, but I love the ramp up of, in the beginning, you're pretty much always just putting it out for the missions and you're funding things, and then you start caring about points and you're mostly going for the points and trying to win either side of the row. But then you're like, oh man, I really need this funding project to happen. So then you're kind of flipping back to get some of those at the end. So I don't know. It's a fun transition through those different decisions when you're placing your worker.
Well, that was tougher with three players, because that last round, Tim's like, we're going to make this one happen, right? And I'm like, yeah, except for the AI player blocked one of the spots.
In the column.
Yeah, and then you went, and then like the last spot was something I didn't want to do, so I'm like, maybe it's not going to happen. I found a different way to do it because that was the one I had maxed out, and it was going to happen. I found a better way of doing it, but yeah, with three players, it could be tougher to make that
thing happen. Yeah, to fund those. Yeah. Other cons?
Ready to move to final thoughts? Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah.
On the Board Boys podcast, we have a 3 boing rating scale, 0 being the worst, 3 being the best. One time you can give a 4 boing rating to a game. Half boings are allowed. In the final thoughts section, we give a rating and what we thought. Tim, since you lapped us in this game, give us a 0 boing and a 3 boing game of Federation.
A 0 boing game of Federation is you are influencing these aliens. They all hate you. You're trying to weasel your way in. You're the snake guy from Lord of the Rings. I don't know what his name is. What's his name?
Golem?
No, the other guy.
The snake guy? Saruman?
No,
the guy that influences the Rowan guy.
Yeah,
Oh man, now you're pulling Lord of the Rings card.
I can see him right
here.
Is it something tongue?
Worm tongue.
Okay. Yeah. So you're him, you get tossed out of the Galactic Senate and you're on your butt losing all the votes.
Sounds like E.T.
Yeah. A 3 boing game was the game that I just had where you not only lap everybody, but at some point in time you double lap them, so you're ahead by 100 points. Then you look at Jake and say,
I don't think you were ever up by 100 points.
I was up by 100 points. And then you look
at
Jake.
You were never up by 100 points.
Yeah, I was up by 100 points. You look at Jake, and you're like, have you played this game before, bro? And
I have a complex when I teach games to people, and nobody else has played it, that I just always do terrible, because I'm just trying to help other people the whole time, and I don't think about my turns enough.
I'm right there with you.
Yep.
Especially if I'm teaching a game and I don't know it well, because I've got my nose in the rule book half the time. It just happens. I'll go first. This game's great. If it wasn't $90, I might even buy it. Maybe I'll get a secondhand copy someday. If you like interaction in your Euro, go get it. It's pretty. I think we played 2 hours for a Euro game.
Teach and play, yeah.
Yeah, teach and play. I think even with 4 players, this is under a 2-hour game probably. There's a lot to like. I think there's a lot of variability. I'm going to go 2.5 boings for this guy, I think. Solid game.
All right. Yeah, I mean, for me, all the same stuff. I really like this game. Yeah, if you like worker placement games that have a little teeth to them, a little interaction, this one, I would certainly definitely suggest picking it up. I'm going to give it a 3. I really like this game. It's really good.
I'm gonna come in at 3 also. I put it 4 times, and you know, I guess what I say every episode now about what makes me like games is does it feel unique? Is it something new that I haven't experienced before? And was I able to do everything that I wanted to? And I definitely think it is very unique, and I have never come close to doing everything that I wanted to do, so that leaves me wanting to play it all the time. So I think it's wonderful. It is a good mix, I think, even for people who like strategy versus people who like tactical games, because there's definitely some long-term planning in regards to which tracks you're going to hit the most, but there are also a lot of times where you need to make the right decision at that moment for how that's going to determine things, and that is something I did a bad job at, but I'm not a tactical player. But I think that it is there for both types of gamer, and I think that's also kind of unique in games. So, big recommendation for me.
I was hoping you'd give it a 3, and we'd all go 3s. I know Cam gives us a 3, so I already wrote it down.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, I'm probably being a curmudgeon. I didn't really have anything negative to say about it.
Yeah.
But, stick with your gut and the bump and dump. You can.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a 2.5. Oh, also, it's on BGA Alpha right now, so I'll play it on there, and the game will take 2 weeks, and then I'll probably hate it again. But let's play some real time Federation.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, that'll be fun.
I'd do that. All right, we are foregoing our normal bumper dump segment because somehow we ended up ahead a couple episodes.
Yep.
We have a couple other segments, though, we were going to throw in this episode and next one. This one, even though it's a little after New Year's, this is coming out, we would like to look back on 2023, check out our BG stats, and give our top 5 games, and maybe some surprises and some games that missed, I think, for us. Is this you both of your first full years doing BG stats?
I think so, yeah.
No, I think I have 2 full years because I started. I have 2 full years. Yep.
Okay. I don't know how many years I've done it now, but every year I tend to record slightly more things. Although I kind of stopped that a couple of years ago, but like I didn't used to record scores and stuff, but now I do. Let's start off with just our year in review, I think. And for me, I'm just going to look at my top 10 games for number of plays that I had. And the games I played the most this year, shockingly enough, are Legacy games.
Go figure.
So Ticket to Ride, Legacy, King's Dilemma, My Island, then Expeditions, which is one of our review games this season, Unmatched, Scout, Last Light, Acropolis, and Boop all show up there for me, with Marrakesh coming right there, right after that. So, there won't be any more tickets. Well, we can continue to play our Ticket to Ride Legacy, but we are done with that. On top of that, I had 464 plays of 231 games, and 150 were new to me. That is up from last year, where only 138 were new to me. So, playing a lot of new games.
Love it.
I'm going to guess my new game count will be down next year, or this year, because one of my challenges is I'm going to try to play my entire collection. I did give me 2 years to do that in the app, so we'll see, because I don't think that's probably doable in a year.
You could do it in a year.
But it'll be fun to hit games that I have not played in quite a while.
So. And you're going to try...
I'm excited. Oh, and I'm playing a game every day. Yeah. And, I mean, I guess it's... Since I'm doing all my games, I'm doing all my unplayed games as well.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And then we do have a board that I got on Etsy that's like a 20x5 board. Normally, I fill that all out at the beginning of the year. I'm just filling it out as we find gems that the family wants to play more. But a couple that are on there are Everdale Big Box, which I played a couple times finally. Don't be scared to open that big box. It's not that bad to get out and set up. And the Castles of Burgundy also, because if you drop that much money on a game, you might as well play it.
All right, I can go next. So the games I played the most of, so number one for me is Barcelona and Heat, the same plays. Then Jaws of Lion, Karuba, and then TI4. Yep.
I love how high that is.
Yeah, yeah. It's the fifth most played game for the year for me. Then we got Woodcraft, Pirates of Maracaibo, Cascadia, and then Joan of Arc, the drawn.
That's a mega Ryan Hendrickson.
Yeah, yeah. Two Ryan games. That's awesome. And then Distilled, I think, is the last of my 10. So, and then for me, 195 plays. Let's see. Where's the new to you section? 76 new games, 46 different people. So it's a good year.
Ooh, I have 142 people.
142 people.
That is a lot.
Normally I play, it's funny, Cam. Oh, I didn't mention this, Tim. You beat Cam on most played with this year. In past years, it's definitely been Cam. Cam used to battle my son for the top spot. But it was Bo crushed everyone this year, and then it was Tim and Cam and Jared, and I don't play games with Jake anymore, apparently.
It had been a minute.
You're number 11.
Number 11?
Yeah.
Okay, so my top 10 games for the year and play totals. I also have some Legacies, which is kind of weird for me because that's not usually the way that I operate, but I have Legacy of You was my most played game, then Ticket to Ride Legacy, My Island, Zuvadis. And then it's Hens, Twilight Imperium 4th Edition, Castle Burgundy Special Edition, White Castle, Wine the Film, or Photograph, and Siberian were my top 10 games.
Nice.
In play. So it's funny when you go to your play time, however, and Twilight Imperium doubled my play time for everything else, despite being quite a bit less in number of plays. So I had 278 plays, 114 games that were new to me, and 65 named players.
Yeah, unfortunately, the played stat is no good for me because I constantly forget to finish a game sometimes in the app, and I'll do it like the next day. So my highest played game is Anomaly, and I played it for like 90 some hours according to BG stats.
Love it.
All right. Well, let's hit our top fives then. Let's go ahead and we'll do number ones through number fives and we'll wrap around.
So are we doing this definitively ranked or are we just saying?
I loosely ranked mine. To be honest, I sorted in BGG by games I've ranked in 2023. And because I figured if I've ranked it, I've played it enough to like it. I normally don't rank games until I have played them a couple of times or like I played it once and I really know my mm-hmm. thoughts. But in one game, beat everything else, and the other games, I had like 10 games tied for the next slot, so and I just picked four of them.
These are games that were released in 2023.
According to BGG, it has the 2023 tag on them.
Okay, I did not do that, and some of mine were 2022s that I just played this year.
That's fine.
That's okay.
That's fine. Okay. Let's start with number five.
Okay.
My number five is Beast. We did an episode on it. It is a hidden movement game. Although the new hidden movement game that I picked up, The Stifling Dark, might fight this for one of my top hidden movement games, I still really, really like Beast, and I haven't played Stifling Dark enough yet. It's more like a hunt and find, hunt and seek, attack each other game. So
yeah,
that's it, Beast.
All right, number five for me, Great Western Trail, New Zealand.
Very nice.
Yeah, I really like that one. It's got much more wombo combo and all that other stuff. I think
it's probably my favorite out of the Great Western Trails.
Yeah, it's good.
I got it for Christmas, but I haven't played it yet, so I'm excited to give it really a try. My number five, and something that I need to play more of, and I think it's here mostly because I haven't played it more. I guess I'm assuming I'm going to keep liking it more. But my number five is Voidfall.
Okay, I
really, really, really have enjoyed that. So
we should play Voidfall.
I'm just going to keep not playing it with Tim.
Yeah, yeah. Rob hates me.
It's not the fact that it takes
an hour to set up.
Yeah.
I mean, I got, five plays of TI4 in, so we can figure this out.
There you go. Yeah. All right. Number four for me is Nucleum. I know it was brought to my attention that we gave it middling reviews. I would like to just bring out the fact that I really do enjoy the game. I'm really excited for the new map. I'm interested if it'll change anything else in the game, but like I really dig Nucleum, so
yeah, it's fine. It's fine. It's good.
It's fine.
It's good.
You do you.
Yep. All right, number four for me, Kunta Hora. This I believe we'll probably do an episode on coming up.
Yep.
Sometime in the next, I don't know, couple weeks.
Spoiler: Tim likes it.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of didn't put it in my list because I also like it, and we're going to talk about it soon, but.
It's good. Maybe
it is good. I also haven't played it enough yet.
Maybe my second play will suck. But maybe. I played it once. I really liked it. I thought it was really good.
Yeah.
Okay. My number four is Encyclopedia. I've played it four times, and I really, really like it. It is definitely unique, and you can just do some fun things with how the scoring works in the end. It's the scoring, I will say, is a little bit to wrap your head around, but it's a lot of fun. I really enjoy it.
That's what I need to try. For me, number three is Voidfall. I have played it probably half a dozen times now. We played it twice at BGG Con. It's real good. We're going to do an episode on it. Unfortunately, it takes a day and a half to set up.
You guys are making me jealous. I just want to, let's play it tonight. All right, number three for me, The White Castle. We talked about it a lot. We had an episode on it. It was, it was season 13, episode 9. So was that five episodes ago? Four episodes ago? I love that game. It's Wombo Combo City. It's super fun. It's quick. You posted about it in the Discord. It was it's a good Euro filler time frame. It's you get done 45 minutes. Probably get done in 30 minutes.
Yeah, I don't see how that game takes over an hour.
Yeah.
If you know how to play it.
The White Castle is really good.
I think we played three players, four players in 25 minutes.
You only get to do 9 things.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, Jake, what you got?
My number four is Federation. So I'm happy we went through. My number three is Federation. I just really, really like this game, and it stood out, and I definitely want to keep playing it. So,
yeah, I mean, it would definitely be in my surprise list upcoming. I'll add it to that.
Yeah.
Number two for me is Thunder Road Vendetta. This is one that I just love Restoration games. I love everything they do. And I was kind of Restoration games out after Dark Tower. I liked Dark Tower, but Thunder Road Vendetta just didn't interest me when the Kickstarter came out, but then I once again saw all these people's Maximum Chromes arriving and saying how cool it was. So as soon as they dropped it on their website, I picked it up and couldn't be more happy with it. We did an episode on it. I'm curious if I gave it 3 boings. I don't remember. But two boings?
2 boings.
Dang. It's one of my most played games of the year, because, and Bo loves it. So that gives it a leg up there for sure. It's definitely at least a 2.5 boinger. And there's a new expansion coming out early this year that's going to be on Kickstarter. So if you want crazy, dumb fun with your friends, this is it.
Tight. All right. Number 2 for me, Pirates of Maracaibo. This would be Season 13, Episode 8. I really enjoy this game. I played it with my 7-year-old the other day. He crushed me. So, I don't know. I mean, he understood it mostly. I think it's great. All the movement, I don't know. I really like the game. It kind of distills a bunch of the Maracaibo vibe, but it's still a different game. I just think it's wonderful. So
I really, really enjoy Pirates of Maracaibo too. I like it more and more all the time that I play it. So I think it's going to be one that keeps growing on me too. So I did get to introduce that to my family over the holidays, and we were kind of distracted, and I think that kind of impacted their opinion about it a little bit, but so I want to bring it back and see how it does again the second time, but I do really, really enjoy it.
I have definitely given up on trying to play any games over a weight of 2.
Yeah.
In any holiday gathering. It's not that people don't want to do it, it's the constant interruptions, mm-hmm. just quick, short, and fast. It's the only thing that works around here, unfortunately.
My number 2 is Orienburger Canal, which is by E.V.A. It's a 2-player game, and man, I love that game too. It is really interesting, and plus that game gives you so much variety. There are like 6 different decks of cards that you can play with that completely change how things work, so I want to play that more and more. I really, really enjoy it.
Like, you can't... The only thing that sucks, you can't really get it, right? Like, you have, like,
I don't know where people find it. It was actually the first game I ever backed on Kickstarter, and I got it like a year later. And
like, if you didn't Kickstart it, like, there's no real way to get it, which is surprising considering
it's
like,
Uwe,
this, yeah. So
interesting.
All right, how about this? Spoilers. We're going to talk about games that surprised you. Orenburg Canal was mine.
Oh, sorry.
Like, no, totally cool. Like, I'll just say it right now.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed that game. It was super fun. It surprised me that, like, how much I actually liked it. I do like Uwe, but, like, it's really good. I would try it if you can find it. That's the only thing that sucks about it. You can't find it, but it's great.
Talk to me. We'll play it.
Yeah.
There you go. My number 1 game is Ticket to Ride Legacy Legends of the West. We played it 5 players with Bo and our neighbors. We have finished the campaign. Did not disappoint. I don't know, 5 stars. I mean, I gave it a 9.5 on BoardGameGeek. That's a half a point higher than these other games. And it might be the legacy game that will actually get replayed here in my house. Like, I have Charterstone, but we've never replayed Charterstone. But Ticket to Ride Legacy, we'll play that again. I really liked the changes in it. And how you play the game at the end of the game is different than the regular Ticket to Ride. So not only do you have your own map, you're still kind of playing the legacy version of this game, which is different than your normal Ticket to Ride. So one thing I really like about it is you don't actually score your routes during the game, so you never have to keep remembering to add points, which you can just add them all up at the end of the game, but you know. Mm-hmm. But Ticket to Ride Legacy, if you like Ticket to Ride and you have an inkling that you might like a legacy game, this is probably in my top 2 legacy games of all time.
Other one, Pandemic?
Yeah, probably Pandemic Season 0, actually. I really liked that one.
Nice. All right. My top game for 2023 was Barcelona. I really like that game. I think, let's see, Season 13, Episode 3, I was the only one to give it 3 boings, the 3 of us. Jake, you were not on the episode. So yeah, I like the action selection. I like the wombo combo and the noodliness of it. I just played it this last weekend again and hit just as hard. I really like that game. It's super fun.
Not as much of a fan of his other game though. Arboria.
Oh my god. Oh, I gotta play that game again. It was fine. I don't know.
my number one game of the year, and I have an asterisk because there's a game that's actually my number one of the game of the year, if it counts, but I don't think it counts. But my favorite game of the year is Legacy of You, which is a solo-only game by Shem Phillips. I just loved it. I mean, I played it 19 times over a really small window, and I did the campaign twice, which, again, that says something, because a lot of times in Legacy, when you get it done, you know, that's the end of it, and there was enough variety to make me instantly want to start it over and do better than I did the first time. So Legacy of You, again, if you like solo games, I think it is just wonderful. My actual number one, though, if it counts, is the Castles of Burgundy Special Edition, because it's one of my favorite games. And there's more stuff in it now. So
yeah,
like,
I mean, if it was 2023. Yeah.
So,
like,
I mean, that's a top three board game for me for all time. So yeah. That obviously is my number one if it counts. So.
I mean, asterisk, it's in there for me too, probably. Yep. So let's hit our surprises. I just have three real quick ones. Last Light, which we played, like, I knew I liked
Bro,
it.
It's not a surprise because we played it in 2022.
I get that, but I was surprised at how much I played it this year.
Yeah, yeah.
It was one of my most played games, and I got it in October for the year. And it's because everyone that I play it with wants to play it a second time. And that says something, I think. You know, even like, because a lot of times the first time you play it, you score like 3 points, and then you're like, I can do better.
Yeah.
And then they want to do better, and we play it again, and it's great. That's not a hat. Also played that game so many times. If you want to feel stupid and have a terrible memory, go pick this game up for $15 or whatever. That's not a hat. Rocks.
That game does make you feel stupid.
You can play that game with anybody. The rounds of it last like 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It's so fun. And it comes in a cute little pink box.
My kid refuses to play it with me because like it just frustrates him so much.
Like, that you're so bad at it?
Just not remembering.
Or that he's bad at it.
Everybody's bad at it. Okay. Like, yeah, just like, I don't want to play this game.
Bo loves that game. And then Anunnaki's the other one. I'm glad I ended up backing it. At first, I was just backing their Kickstarter to get all the cool extra stuff that Cranio had for all their other games. And then I'm like, you know what? It's a Luciani game. Something different that he's never done before. And I'm really happy with it. So,
how many times have you played that now?
Three or four.
Okay. I want to play it again.
I want to play with more of the stuff.
Yeah.
And there's actually even like a little campaign. I wouldn't mind trying to play through some of those different scenarios. The game seems like it plays vastly differently.
Hmm.
Vastly differently? That doesn't sound like good English.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. So for me, we talked about Orenburger.
Yep.
Oren Canal. And then Beast was another one that I put on the list.
Yeah.
I don't love games like that usually. I like hidden movement games. I don't know. Like, just not totally my games. I really like that one. I thought that was really good. It was cool.
I only have a Calyx cube and a half of hidden movement games.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. I mean, I like them enough.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, I really like that. That was a great game. That was great. We did that was season 12, episode 7.
Very nice.
Yeah.
For me, I have two. One is new and one is actually really old, but it's really taken me by surprise, so I wanted to mention it. The first one I want to say is Ticket to Ride Legends of the West. So outside of the Hadrian's Wall solo campaign and Legacy of You's solo campaign, I don't think I've ever finished... Queensdale. I finished Queensdale with Rob and Cam.
Yeah.
Other than that, I don't think I'd ever finished a non-solo player Legacy game, and I am 9 games into the Ticket to Ride, and we're definitely going to finish it. So I've really enjoyed it. I'm not the biggest Legacy guy, especially when it's a big setup and getting the people back, and this has just kept drawing us back to it. So I've been very, very pleasantly surprised with it. And again, I wouldn't have said that Ticket to Ride would have been mentioned on my top games in any regard, but and I like Ticket to Ride, but I think it's just a statement to how good the Legacy is. The other one I want to mention is Wind the Film. It's old, but man, do I love that game. It hurts your brain in the right way, and just the planning that you need to do with it is so much fun. So that was a big time surprise for me as well.
It's great. It's wonderful.
I think I just talked about that once before.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds interesting. So my, I guess, biggest disappointment, because I didn't know about the game, but I just went through and I looked at my lowest rated game of the year, and there's a couple of them tied. I'm giving it to East India Company that I played with Jake. I just did not like that game.
I thought you said not that long ago you wanted to play it again. Had been thinking about it a lot.
That was probably me.
Oh,
yeah. No, I definitely have never thought about that game again. Okay. And would play it again, but I would never opt to play it again as a first choice.
It almost made my surprising games list. Like, I really like that
I don't
game.
Know.
Yeah. I want to play it again.
Yeah. It was like a... It was a 6, so it's not like it was. I gave it like a 3 or something, but yeah, it was just one of the lowest rated games I had. Didn't do it for me.
All right, so I put Earth here, like not because like I had very high expectations for it, but everybody else freaking loves this game, and I played it in person a couple times. I played it on BGA like 8 times. It sucks. That game sucks. Like
hot take.
Like everybody loves it. I don't know what they love. I cannot get myself to care about the game at all. Like putting cards out, getting like it's just like I don't care enough to think about this game hard enough to figure out where to put a card. I don't know.
It did not stay in my collection. Yeah. So although I did rate it at 8.5.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I mean, that was a good game, but it was a game that I don't really want to play all the time. So I can feel you.
Yeah.
I went through recently and went through all my rankings, and I thought I had too much game inflation and all my scores are way too high. So I went back with a brutal rating for how I have things sorted now. So even in my collection, I have games that are as low as 4s for me.
Mm. Oh, wow.
And then so I only have 2 games that I gave a 10 to, and then it's 3 games with a 9.5. So I spent like a whole couple days doing that. Anyways, my biggest disappointment is Resist, which is also a solo kind of legacy game. I mean, it's not. There is a campaign, although you don't need to play it. I was right off the heels of me being so into the solo campaign on Hadrian's Wall, and this was on Kickstarter. It looked really, really interesting. Essentially, you have a card, and it's got 2 sides. You play a weaker version of it to keep it in your deck, or you play the better version, and it leaves, which is something that's also in Legacy of You, but I just don't like it. It just feels so random what comes up and the cards you get just not being capable of beating the things that are out there. And there's nothing you can do mid round to really augment that and make it different. Like you can lose one mission, but if you lose another one, you lose. So it's just like if you get one bad draw or the cards that are upside down that you flip to access that mission are bad for you. Like, that's 50% of your game is gone, and you, I don't know. I really wanted to like it. I was really excited about it. It's about the Spanish Civil War. So the theme is super cool for a former social studies teacher, but I just am not into it. And I have tried. I've played that game a lot of times. So Resist is my biggest disappointment.
Resist and liking it.
Yeah. They have a new one coming out that's about witches. And so again, the art looks super cool, but it's like the same mechanisms. And I was like, don't do it, Jake. You didn't like the other one, so I didn't back it. So
there you go. Well, I think that's it for another episode of the Board Boys Podcast, season 13, episode 13, or I guess season 14, episode 14, if you want to go that way. I'd like to thank our patrons, Hammond Buckland, BJ from Board Game Gumbo, Shifty Teeth, David Dugas, Andre Bosch, Jeremy Toman, Braden Dowdy, Rob Cooper, Richard Lane, and Board Game Bastard. If you'd like to support us on Patreon, go to theboardboys.com, click on the Patreon link. You can go there. Also, you can get the link to our Discord there, Facebook, Instagram, all that good stuff. We post lots of good content, or content. It's up to you if it's good or not, I suppose.
I mean, they're providing money, so they have to think it's kind of good. Right?
There you go. Well, until next time, we hope you like board games.
Insert cam joke.
Boing, boing, boing.
All Hit Radio.
All right, you're listening to All Hit Radio, and it's 53 degrees at 13 minutes past the hour. And right now in our All Request line, I've got Mike Ledgerwood on the phone. Hey, babe, what would you like to hear? Hey, babe, I'm sorry. I can't hear you too well. You're going to have to speak a little closer into the phone. Okay, babe, what would you like to hear again?
We are observing your Earth.
Hey, Mike, I'm sorry, babe, but that's not on our playlist. And by the way, you sound great over the phone. Anyway, if you give us your request, we'll be glad to play it for you, babe. So let's hear it.
We are observing your Earth.
Listen, Mike, I'm sorry, babe, but we can't...
And we'd like to make...
I'm sorry, Mike, we... There's...
A contact with you. Baby.
In your mind, you have capacities, you know, to telepath messages through the vast unknown. Please close your eyes and concentrate with every thought you think upon the recitation we're about to say. Calling occupants of interplanetary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary most extraordinary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary craft.
Send a message, we declare world contact day.